Hi, I'm Jim McVittie. This is part four of a four-part series of lectures on dry etching. In this lecture, I'm going to talk about choosing a dry etching process and tool. Previously, I gave an introduction to dry etching, and then followed by basic plasmas and types of dry etching tools, followed by dry etching mechanisms. In this lecture, I'm going to cover what are the issues that control etch process choice, chemistry choices, and I'll talk about the role of the use of boiling points to help determine useful etch products, and polymer trade-offs in oxide etching. I'll then cover etch strengths in different materials and end with a comparison between different etch configurations. What issues control etch process choice? Here we show a diagram we showed previously of our photoresist over a film that were being etched over a substrate and the polysilicon etch case. What etch tools and process should we use to get desired etch characteristics for our structure? So here's going through some of the issues. First is, are there volatile etch products? What etch profile is needed? How anisotropic do I want it? Etch depth. The etch depth controls selectivity needs. What is the MAC material? Stopping material? Allowed losses? Deeper depths require higher rates and higher selectivities. If we're talking about really deep and we're talking about silicon, then we can use what we call the deep silicon etch process. We're fluorine based. We're switching between etch and deposition. This is known as the Kabach process. Another issue is wafer temperature. We can set the temperature in the reactor, and then we also have wafer heating depending on the process conditions, how much hour power we have and bias power. Temperature affects the etch and depth rates, affect profile, selectivity, and it can affect resist degradation. If the resist gets too hard, it can degrade and be very difficult to remove and actually affect the profile as we're going deeper. And finally, in terms of etch temperature, we have many of our tools have backside helium used to improve the heat transfer between the wafer and the electrodes. And finally, we have the issue of initial breakthrough. Some of the steps we will begin with a step that will just remove any oxide or polymer before we begin the process. This is very important when you have a very high selectivity process. You have to start with your material, and oxide can slow you down. So sometimes you go in and just remove that oxide and then switch to the high selectivity process. Chemistry choices. For etching, we have, for the case of silicon and germanium, we use halogens, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, to form halides, volatile halides, and that fluorine tends to be faster but more isotropic than the chlorine and bromine. For metals, we use the halogens also to form metal halides, which may or not be volatile. We may need boron trichloride and a sputtering to remove an initial oxide. Boron trichloride is very interesting chemically in that it not only removes lots of oxides, it also, when it's in the gas chemistry, it removes any water vapor oxygen that may be coming from the surfaces or other places. So it really generates an environment void of any oxidizers. Metal oxide and nitrites, we use halogens again, plus iron bombardment and maybe boron trichloride. For silicon oxide, we tend to use carbon fluorides mixtures, plus maybe CHF3 with the CF4 compound may have CH3 added or not, or maybe hydrogen added. Plus, we add in additives that will enhance or reduce deposition, such as oxygen and fluorine that tend to remove the polymer and therefore give it better control. For nitride, we can either use an oxide etch or we can use a fluorine-based etch where we add the oxygen or nitrogen. For polymer, we typically use oxygen, but we can add either argon or fluorine to help the process. Fluorine is added when you have a really tough polymer. Sometimes a little bit of fluorine added to oxygen will break through a tough polymer that has a lot of cross-linking. And argon is used when we want to add more iron bombardment. Inhibitory deposition, we use the fluorocarbons, CaSF3, hydrogen, and sometimes both nitrogen or oxygen can help with the inhibitory deposition. And looking for controlling sidewalls and anisotropic etching. When we have marginal byproduct volatility, we often increase the temperature and also increase iron bombardment. The downside is that the increased temperature and iron bombardment can damage the photoresist and lower selectivity. In this slide, I'm going to talk about the use of boiling points to evaluate possible byproducts. So I have here is a table of different elements, and I have chloride products, fluoride products, and their boiling points. And the reason we use look at boiling points is boiling points are often easily available, whereas from possible products, the data for vapor pressures at the temperature we're doing the etching is not available. But we can extrapolate roughly what the vapor pressure is at the operating temperature from boiling points. Let me show you a diagram here. What I have here is a plot of temperature versus vapor pressure for the case of gallium tetrachloride. And we see here at the top here, here's the atmospheric pressure. We have the boiling point at about 200 degrees C. Now down here at 50 degrees C, what might be a typical etching temperature, we see the vapor pressure is on the order of 1 millitorr. And that millitorr, 1 to 10 millitorr is where we like to have for the byproduct so that they come off the surface. So we see here the relationship between boiling point and vapor pressure at the operating temperature. We can use boiling point to help us determine possible byproducts. And so typically we're interested in boiling point less than 200 degrees for wafers. We're going to be operating near room temperature, or less than 300 degrees for wafers might be heated. So let's take an example here. Here I take aluminum. So aluminum chloride has a boiling point, actually sublimes at 180 degrees C, whereas aluminum fluoride has a boiling point of 1200 degrees or 1300 degrees. So we see, obviously, if we're going to etch aluminum, we want to use chlorine. When we take a look at copper, we see copper chloride has a boiling point of 1500 degrees C. Copper fluoride is 1100 degrees, so basically we're not going to etch very well copper, either chlorine or fluorine. And here we go, here silicon case. Here look at silicon tetrafluoride has a boiling point of 60 degrees C, whereas silicon tetrafluoride has a boiling point of minus 86 degrees. So it means that silicon is going to have fluoride is going to come off easier, so we're probably going to have a higher etch rate. If we know we have a higher etch rate with fluorine, but we can easily etch this temperature, a boiling point of 60 degrees C for silicon tetrachloride is well within range that we can easily have do etching. And as we've shown throughout the lectures, that chlorine does a very good job on etching silicon. So here I show a polymer trade-off for oxide etching. What I have here, I'm showing basically temperature of pressure on one side. I'm talking thinking very low pressure to a high pressure one tor. And typically, we're going to get much, at the high pressure, we can have low ion energy because of all the collisions. At low pressures, we're going to have high ion energy. And then in the x-axis here, I'm showing the fluorocarbon composition. So that as one side, I'm adding oxygen and fluorine. And so in this case, I'm going to have a lot more free fluorine going on. And this one, X oxide, but at high pressures with the high fluorine case, we can actually get isotropic etching of oxide. But this is up near the one tor range. Well, at low pressures, as we rather than adding oxygen, we typically go for maybe hydrogen or adding carbon. We go more toward the polymer deposition range, and there's a reason. Before we get to actual deposition of polymer, we get the most anisotropic etching. We get very anisotropic. If we go more towards the deposition threshold, we actually get getting wall slope, and the etch rate drops down. And we see that at high pressures, we get polymer deposition occurs much earlier than at low pressures. So this kind of trade off. And then we also talk about selectivity. If we have if we want selectivity between SiO2 and silicon, we want to be near the transition of the polymer. So if we go here, we go from etching in to actually deposition regime here. So in oxide etching, normally we're trading off between selectivity, anisotropic, and the exact composition of the gas we're using, typically fluorocarbons. And next I show some etching strengths for different materials. And I go kind of from the worst case to the best case. The best case and the classic thing is silicon, where we can get very high selectivities, 1,000 to 1 with a hard max, or 100 to 1 with a resist max, high etch rates, high aspect ratio. So this is the best case. This is the poster child that we show on how well we can do. On the other end, we have the very physical etching, such as platinum, nickel, and these things are, we really can't, there's no chemistry to etching material, and this is all physical sputtering, where we have low selectivities, low rates, low aspect ratio. And then other materials in between, we have rates not as good as silicon, but we can get reasonable rates and selectivities and all that for the other materials. So gallium arsenide is somewhat easier to do in oxide, but even oxides, we can get fairly good results. So it's kind of the trade-off. Silicon gives you the very best results. Some of the cases that are ion-only give you the worst results. So here I'm talking about the X mechanism. I kind of showed this slide before, and that so etching trends. So if we go in lower pressure, more physical, higher pressure, more chemical, and then we want to typically to get the best, if we can, get some chemistry and the interaction between chemistry and ion bombardment, then we get lock and control, and then this gives us the highest rates and the most control over profile. And this shows the trade-off between the different tools. The downstream metrics, we really talk about pure chemical processes. The CCP RIE tend to be very ion-driven processes. The RIE for the high energy ion energies. The plasma mode for the lower ion energies. And the ICP gives it the high range and a range of ion energies. Okay. So now we've covered mechanisms, chemistry, in the previous lecture, in the beginning of this lecture. When I look at how do we choose a particular tool and process for a given etch case? So we're going to look at the case of etching polycrystalline silicon on a silicon dioxide layer. First, I want to look at the case of isotropic etching, shown in the profile here. We want a deep undercut. And for the chemistry, for a reason I talked to you before, we want to use fluorine chemistry because it actually spontaneously doesn't need any ion bombardment. And the source gases are going to be SF6, which gives you lock of free fluorine, or CF4 and O2 that also gives you lock of fluorine, not quite as much as you get with SF6. And we're going to want to use, because we don't want to allow the effect of ions, we want a low ion bombardment process. And to keep the low ion energy down, we want to use high pressure would be better. So that means CCP plasma mode downstream or ICP with low bias. For anisotropic etching of polysilicon, we want to go to chlorine HBR. This is a well-known chemistry, and it's basically chlorine gives you an anisotropic etching of polysilicon, but it tends to have problems with micro-crunching, and so we add we get more a bigger process window if we add HBR chemistry. So it gives you a little bit of sidewall deposition and not quite a sharp corner and less of a tendency for microcrunching than chlorine by itself. For this case, we want to use intermediate ion energy, range of 100 volt bias, and low pressures, less than 50 millitorr. And there could be CCP RIE mode or ICP. And finally, for the near anisotropic profile case, we again want to use fluorine chemistry, but with deposition. And this can be SF6 with F2Cl, one of the freons, or SF6 C4F8. And so this is a combination of the fluorine coming from the SF6 with the deposition from the additive gas. In this case, you want to use intermediate energies, sometimes maybe 50 volt bias, intermediate pressure 50 to 100 millitorr, and they can be using CCP plasma mode, or we can also use ICP since it gives a range of energy possibilities. Okay, let's cover the summary. In this section, we've shown the process and tool choices depend on material to be etched and desired etch profile. Byproduct volatility dictates chemistry choices. Chemistry, etch depth, and profile dictates etch mechanism choices, which dictates mask, process / recipe, and tool choices. One can use the presented material as a guide in the following three ways. First, for selecting the best process from available processes and tools. Second, for indicating important parameters to monitor during the F processes. And finally, for adjusting parameters in follow-up rungs to achieve desired X goals. Thank you.